Yah. Shabbat Shalom, Yisrael. We do truly give Almighty Yahweh and His Son Yahshua HaMashiach all of the honor and the praise that is due unto their Kodesh names. We do Toda Yah for that, for the gift of our lives, the health and strength in which we possess, for the simplicity of the very activity of our limbs. We have in Almighty Yahweh our essence, our being, our totality, so that we have so much to honor the Most High in, and to always give Torah to Yah, to give great thanks and praise unto Him, just because of those simple things. The greatness of Yahweh's word really will allow Yisrael to come to a perfect working relationship with the Most High. This is beyond what the world projects when they all take the name of whatever their gods are continually in vain. But this is a relationship. This is something so perfected that Yah has worked out before the very foundation of the world. You will find that you can read through the word of Yah and teach people over and over many of the great and wondrous things in Yah's word, but you can never fully articulate and express the depth and beauty of Yah's word to a people who each and every one of them have to come to experience Almighty Yahweh for themselves. That is where the beauty of a perfect working relationship with Almighty Yah comes into play. You see, when you teach the people of Yahweh that this is not a game, that you are among all the people of the earth, and there are roughly 7 billion plus people on the planet, but to study what's written in the word, I don't mean in a sense of a fanatic now, I'm just meaning someone that sincerely seeks out the knowledge of Yah's word. I'm going to tell you something. When you come to the understanding that of all the people and all the families of the earth, and He says in His word to Yisrael that you only of all the families of the earth have I known. That's a powerful statement. That is such a powerful statement that it elevates one to a level of understanding in HaMashiach, where you now look out at the world and realize the world does not know Him. They don't know Him. And the world demonstrates that they don't know Him by all of the many unpleasantries that they practice on a day-by-day basis. Today's topic is a topic, I've preached this here before, I'm going to do this one again for the sake of the family in Yahshua that may be listening by way of the live stream. I want to run back through this message, and it will probably be so diverse from February when I preach this same message here that I'm more than certain that you will be enjoying this for the first time, just as anyone that's watching or witnessing this as we go through this. So I want to talk with you today about the word of Yahweh and how the word of Yahweh is free of all imperfections. Hallelujah. I'm going to slow walk us through. I'm going to show you the dynamic power of Yahweh, who entrusted men with His word. People don't believe that Yahweh has called men and He has placed an intricately detailed, such a profound level of understanding of the things that He has said and done in the minds of men that they seek to discuss it. They seek to debate it. They seek to challenge it. And when you sit down with enough of them as I have, you learn they haven't even read this book. See, after a while, it's a complete and utter waste of time to discuss things with people who have not even read the book. Come on, man. We don't study Yah's word as we're commanded to study the word of Yah. The word of Yah brings great joy, brings great peace, it brings great delight. I was listening as Deacon read something out of the Torah and that verse about singing unto Yah. I remember when I was a little boy in the Assemblies of Yahweh, Mother Virginia Johnson, she took a psalm and to heal him, I believe it's 150, and she sang that verse. She did that thing so beautifully. And she says, let the high praises of Yahweh be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand. And I got to thinking on that thing as the brother was reading it. I said, yeah, mother was saying that. That's in the book. Because the people that knew Yah so well could sing unto Yah. They could serenade the Most High because they had such a perfect working relationship. You think you've been in love in the earthly sense? Yeah, come on. That type of feeling cannot touch the relationship that Yah has bestowed upon the children of Yisrael. More often than not, we simply do not believe. So then Yah's word comes across in an extremely in-depth manner. It comes across in a manner that puts the mouths of the gainsayers to silence. That's what the word of Yah does. That word shuts us down. One of the most beautiful aspects of Yah's word is how he has an answer for everyone. I don't care who you are. I don't care how smart you are. I don't care what degrees you have. I don't care if you're dropped out in pre-K. He has an answer somewhere in his word for every silly thing that we're thinking. And then when we are thinking what we call on a grand scale, in our own false sense of wisdom in our minds, he has an answer for us. And if we study the word close, we can pull that out. I'm going to try to do that today, y'all willing. Is that all right with you? You better say it's all right. I'm going to do it whether you agree or not. Yah's word is the beauty and delight of Yah's word. I say this to the children all the time. Don't stray from the commandments of Yah. When the way of Yah looks dark and slippery unto you, you hold on and you hold on to Yah's unchanging hand. Notice my careful use of the word unchanging. Unlike man, Yahweh does not switch up on us, man. We switch up on him. Come on, we switch up. And when we switch up on Yah, we look for people of like mind to support us when we backslide, to support us when we rebel, to support us when we just flagrantly transgress. Come on, man, we can't do that. We're commanded to, ye that are filled with the Ruach, to restore such a one. We're commanded to restore them. And that we're not going to pet the one on the head as they openly and flagrantly transgress the Torah of Yah. We have no idea what we're doing. So then you got to teach the people of Yahweh to walk humbly, gently with Yahweh, to just relax. Take your time and to learn of him. He says, take my yoke upon you. This is what HaMashiach said. He says, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. See, we get all overwhelmed with the yoke and the burden of the world, the yoke of the job, the yoke of the rent, the yoke of the car payment. We get overwhelmed by all of that because we put our trust in those things, so that when it comes time to fully leaning upon Yahweh and Yahushua, we stumble every time because we put all our trust and all our effort in the things of this world. Man, I want to show you the beauty of Yah's word. Let's do this. Turn with me, if you will. Let's go to the book of Proverbs. Let's go right there. I'm going to go to Proverbs 30:5. We're going to use this as what you would call your springboard. This is your jump off point. How about that? This is the opening. This is the jump off point. This is where we're going to lay the backdrop for understanding today when we say that the word of Yahweh is completely free of imperfections. I've found that so many times the so-called scholars and the experts of the world, they always want to debate this. But there is a group of people in the world that when they read this book, and you'd be silly to sit up all the days of your life and read this book and not come to the understanding that the book is talking about you. I want to make that perfectly clear. Come on now. I'm not going to be impressed or even enticed by the wisdom of men who claim themselves to be the people of this book. But the people of this book are going to do exactly as the word of Yah commands that they do. And then they're going to see and understand that they're able to live out their days in this life as short of a time span as Yah has cut and given unto us. One can take great delight and honor in Yah and can go to one's grave in peace, resting assured that they will resurrect and they will see his face in perfect shalom. Come on, man. That's the essence of life, man. I don't care what they're talking about here. We talk about all the things in this world. You know, we watch people, they, oh, he's blessing me. I have a car. Oh, he blessed me with a good 10-room home. Oh, I have this, I have that. Come on. The wicked of the world have all that. Do they or do they not have the same ability to proclaim that he's blessing them too? So they have all that and they don't know him. You say you have some of that and you say you know him. Until times get a little hard, then we shift our alliances. You get the difference? See, somebody's got to really take their time and teach the people of Yahweh the things that are written in the book. You can take delight in Yah's word. Sometimes you can have problems and things that are pressing down on you so bad. and you catch yourself and you reflect and you realize, I won't even let that bother me. I'm not talking about somebody that just ignores everything. I'm talking about the fact that one can take delight in Yah's word and say, I'm not going to be impressed by that. And I'm going to take great delight in Yah's word. Therefore, you're not overwhelmed by that. The scripture teaches you plainly. It says, many are the trials of the righteous. It says many. So you're going to have many trials and many tribulations. It says, but Yahweh brings them out of them all. A lot of times we don't even trust Yahweh in his word. He says, I'll bring you out of them all. If he's going to bring you out of them all, and you're young, having gone through something, and already you're giving up, then you haven't even gone through all that he says he's going to bring you out of. See, a lot of times we just don't even want to go through it. Then live as best we can. That way he'll lighten the burden. Do you hear what I say? Proverbs 30 and 5 says this. Every word of Yahweh is pure. You hear that? I'm going to use that right. That's your springboard. If you're going to do any swimming today, we're going to dive off the board with this. Every word of Yahweh is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. That's key. You have to put your trust in him. A lot of times, people don't trust Yahweh. They talk of him. Hallelujah. Shalom. That's what we do. We talk of him. But the applicability of that, that's where it stops. We stop right there. We don't apply this. He says, add thou not unto his words. I want you to hear that. Add thou not unto his words. Both sentences use word. Lest he reprove you and you be found a liar. So don't go adding to Yahweh's word. We don't need to put our own interpretation on the word of Yahweh. That's where men get in trouble. That's why they try to find fault with the scriptures. I've heard them say that all the time. The man told me, he says, well, I don't read the Bible. The Bible has too many contradictions in it. I said, what kind of contradictions can it have in it that Catholicism doesn't have in that? He said, well, just too many contradictions in it. A man that's drinking now, he says, I don't drink as much as I used to. That's what he told me. I don't drink as much as I used to. He says, eventually I'm going to get around to not drinking. I said, what's going to happen? They're going to stop making it? I want them to understand that sometimes that's what it takes for people to stop doing some of the things that they do. But now, Yah's word here, don't add to it. Lest he reprove you. So when you start teaching people that the word of Yahweh is completely free of imperfections, what people don't realize, it's free of imperfection because it's all given by the inspiration of Yahweh. He's not going to inspire his messengers to write things and then shield and protect those things for thousands of years through the hands of various nations into which they have fallen, and he still protects that, and there not be something behind that. Come on now. They can edit Shakespeare and other things. There are literatures and works of men that have been in existence that are now out of print. But Yah's word, come on, man. Look at the validity of that. Has been translated into practically every language upon the face of the earth. I want you to hear me. I use that word perfectly. Translated. Be clear, because when they translate, they carry things over to another language, it means to change. So they've changed some things. Let's be clear on that. If I can pull it, I'll try to do that. I want you to hear me as I step into later the opening of the wisdom of Sirach, because that's one of the key things that he tells the people about the language of Yahweh, is that when it's spoken in the Hebrew language and then carried over to another language, in no language upon the face of the earth do the words and the meaning of Almighty Yah carry the same depth, weight, and clarity, though he means it. People don't understand that Hebrew language, it is the language of creation. Yah told Father Abraham that language ceased from among men when he confounded the languages at Babel. When he sent the messengers unto Abraham to teach him to speak unto him, the book of Jubilees says that he commanded him to speak unto him in the Hebrew tongue. It says in the language of creation. There's a reason why Yah spoke to him in that. When he confounded the languages, he understood them all. He's not baffled by them as we are. So men today, they have tampered with the word. And there's a penalty for that. People don't believe that. There's a penalty for having tampered with the word of Yah. And today, everybody's an expert. Oh, man, you hear, man? Everybody's an expert. Come on, man. And a woman told me earlier this week, don't call them Yahweh. That means chicken pig or chicken snake. Come on, woman, you're stupid. So you're going to live your life understanding Facebook memes and posts, and you think that stupid stuff is wisdom and knowledge. Sit down. When you begin to tell the people the things of Almighty Yah, they don't even understand the depth and the clarity of why Yah put his word, why he entrusted his word into the hands and the mouths of his messenger. They don't even understand that. So today everybody wants to teach. Come on, you got little boys out on the corner. They'll teach you and curse you all in the same breath. Come on, man. They'll get out there and proclaim his word, so they think, and then won't even uplift his Kodesh name. Come on, man. The word of Yah is free of imperfections like that. You think Yah is going to have a damnable, dirty name like that and nobody stand up for the truth? These people don't study. And I'm going to tell you, when you know, listen to me, when you know that you don't study, that you do not diligently inquire, that you do not pray that Abba Yahweh open your understanding, you do well to just be quiet. You hear what I say? You do well to just be quiet. There's nothing more humiliating than to be in a room, to be in a school, to be in a class, to take a course or whatever it is, and come to realize that you probably know less than everyone else in the room. There's nothing more humbling, humiliating, and embarrassing than that. But in all honesty, that's the only approach we should all take to coming to understand Yahweh's word. That's how we are elevated in Yahshua. But today everyone comes and they already know. Let's do this. I'm going to go back and forth through the book. I got about 10 to 12 scriptures. I'll just take my time. I'll run through that. And we're going to enjoy the Shabbat. How about that? We have one today that's going to be presented or formally introduced to the congregation. We're going to do that right during the recess as we gather. We're going to do that. That way everyone can do that. Yah wants his people to fellowship. He wants them to get together. He wants them to be formally introduced to one another, to know each other, because you are the family in Yahshua. Yah doesn't work in confusion. Yisrael has to understand that they are a family, that they are the body, and they should take delight in knowing that Abba Yahweh has called and chosen a nation who was given the command to go ye therefore and teach all nations. It wasn't the nations to come teach Yisrael. Yeah. You were to teach them, which means you've got to know your subject matter, man. You hear what I say? We got to know this. Let's do this. New Testament, as they like to call it. Let's go back into the book of 2 Timothy. I'm going to see if I can pull this out here real quick. The people of Yahweh should really search these things out and come to an understanding of it as best we can, to be able to sit down and quietly look at this. What are we saying? The word of Yahweh is free of imperfections. I say completely free of imperfections. Now I want you to hear what he commanded the messenger Shaul to write unto Timothy when he wrote this letter. Because see, a lot of times we'll get things, letters in the mail, we receive booklets, pamphlets, we don't read it, we'll skim it, we'll look at it, we think we have it, and we'll walk away from it. But now, you cannot do that with Yah's word. You got to take your time. You got to look at the word. You got to look at every detail of it. You got to look at the craftsmanship that Yah put in it. If you bought yourself a brand new Maserati, you'd know every detail on that thing. You'd look at the rims. You'd look at the key. You'd look at the ignition switch. You'd look at the contour of the interior. You'd look at the leather seating. You'd know that thing. So then the word of Almighty Yah is fine craftsmanship that leads unto the salvation of one's soul. We need to treat it as such. Listen to this. He says, 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is given by inspiration of Yahweh. You hear that? He has to inspire one to write this down. All scripture is given by inspiration of Yahweh and is profitable for doctrine. That's it. That's the purpose of what you do. You lay this down. This is sound doctrine. For reproof. Sometimes you have to reprove to people that they're wrong. You have to rebuke them. You have to reprove them and show them this is what Yahweh says. And for correction. Sometimes we're wrong. You have to show people, no, that's not what Yah commands. You have to do it this way. And for instruction. Because sometimes we don't know how to live. We don't know how it is to be conducted. We don't know how to carry out the aspects of Torah. So it's for instruction. You hear that? In righteousness. Fairness, justice, peace, sadika. It's for that. You hear me? But I want you to listen to this. He does not exclude the woman, but I want you to understand what he says here. He says that the man of Yahweh may be perfect. I want you to hear that. That the man of Yahweh may be perfect. It says thoroughly furnished unto all tov work. You hear that? Unto all good work. Thoroughly furnished. Be perfect. Now I want you to, you can just jot this down. I'm not even going to go there. I'm going to quote this. Genesis 25:27 is the perfect working example of a perfect man. You see, when you get there, you read of Jacob and Esau. You learn that the scripture says that Jacob was a plain man. Come on now. Yah uses that word. He uses the word in the Hebraic construct, tom. Tom man. Meaning, he was perfected. He had within him, according to the Ruach, he had within him all that was required to set up his family, to go and to live his life in Almighty Abba Yahweh, and to set the example for generations to come, to set the tone and the direction for the salvation of Yisrael. Am I correct? He had it all within him. That's what the word says. Atonement. He was complete. People think it means plain. Oh, he was just, people say, I heard a man say, oh, he was just old plain Jane. That's not what that meant, my friend. The man was perfected. He had it in him. A lot of times we have the potential within us to honor Yah, to obey, and to keep his Torah. We don't even know it until somebody puts some pressure on us and make us stand up and do it. But yet we'll go to school. In gym class, they'll make us run. They'll make us exercise. You don't think you can do it. The coach put a little more pressure on you. Next thing you know, you come back with a championship. Because they pulled out of you what you did not even know was there. Yah is with you, Yisrael. We just don't believe that. We tend to doubt Yahweh. We tend to not understand that Yah has a perfect working relationship with Yisrael. That is an eternal excellency. Are you listening? This is eternal. It is unto you, and it is unto your children, and unto your children's children. And the scripture says, unto as many as are afar off. Now, we're far off in comparison to when those words were spoken. We're still here today because of that. And we don't even take delight in that. Sometimes, come on, man. Sometimes just the reading of something like that lets you told a Yah to look up and remember, I'm not worthy, but yet you said that I am. Come on now. People don't delight in Yah's word like they should. Every Shabbat, something come up. Every Shabbat, something come up. It don't happen in my life like that. I'm telling you right now. It don't happen in mine. If I'm not here, you better know this. I got to be bad off sick to not come into the house of Yah. My old man used to say when I was a little boy, he says, people need to learn how to press on. So you don't know. You get to the house of Yah, you'll feel better when you get there. I have found that to be true. The days you wake up, your body don't always feel so great, so grand. At least a little excuse. Well, I think I'm going to chill today. You didn't chill Tuesday. Come on, I think I'm going to relax. I'm going to lay low. You were laying low Tuesday. You were laying low Monday. You were laying low Wednesday. Didn't even know it. You were high strung with your energy because the boss says, be here 8 o'clock, baby. And you were there. 7:15. You hear what I say? But when it comes to Yah, we find all manner of excuses to disregard his Torah. Yah said that Israel cast his law behind their backs. And then he says that they walked the way backward. Now that's weird. That's moonwalking. You want to know the truth about it? Come on now. You are facing the Torah and you walking away backward. Not even wise enough to turn and walk in the direction which you're trying to go. You walk away backward. So you're facing what you should be walking towards. Come on, man. We're in deep trouble as a nation. And you cannot tell us that because today everybody knows everything that there is to know about the word of Yahweh. Everybody already knows. Come on. Silly little women. They already know. All you can do is look at their daughters. Mm-hmm. Look at that. All you can do is look at their sons. Mm-hmm. Look at that. Some little men, they already know. All you can do is look at their home lives. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Look at that. Yah's watching. He's keeping score. My dear brothers, you think that you watching the Lakers and the Tar Heels and all these other different groups, all this stuff, you think you're keeping score. You think you know the stats. I'm going to tell you, you're not a statistician like Yah. There's a day coming when every sin and every transgression will be called out before us all. And the Torah says aloud, we better do right by Almighty Yah. You hear me? Let me do this. Let's go back to Psalms. Let's go back to Tehillim 78. I'm gonna slow walk you through the perfection of this relationship. Just to set the backdrop in my limited understanding of Yah's word. Hear me say that. My limited understanding of Yah's word. I pray that Yah bless me to be able to open this up so that we can comprehend that. You know, sometimes when you say open up a thing, people don't even understand the beauty of that. Think about life now. I want you to hear the beauty of this. A babe now, a newborn babe. Now think of this, you all. Yah grants wisdom unto that child. That child can perceive and understand specific things that are spoken while it is yet in the womb. The way that one lives, the mother, the father, while their child is procreated, all those things go into the depth of their child's being and the essence of their character. Here's what Yah does. In every language upon the face of the earth, you can be taken as a child to another country and never see the native land in which you were born. You'll come up somehow, some way, with a level of comprehension where you learn the language where you are. That's dynamic, man. That's the power of Yah in dealing with man's mind to give an ability to conceive and understand the thing. You think we just thank Yah for the activity of our limbs and the essence of our being just to be saying words? Come on now. We don't understand anything until Yah forms the ability of that understanding in our minds. This is why the whole world is guilty before Almighty Yah, and they are without excuse. But Yisra Yah has a little more to deal with, because see, HaMashiach told you, it is given unto you to know the mysteries. That's what it says. Come on. The book of Yeshayah, 59, 20, 21, and I'm going to get to that. He says that Yah's word is not to depart out of your mouth, nor out of the mouth of your seed, nor out of the mouth of your seed, Olam. He said, forever, man. That thing is spiritual, man. That thing is genetic, man. That thing is familial, man. I ain't talking a familiar spirit. I mean, it is a family. It is the family of Yahshua. People get offended when you say that. Come on, man. There are others claiming to be Yisrael. They won't even follow what Torah commands. Now, come on. They'll put on a good show before the world. They'll demand that the world respect them. But the things that Torah simply demands, they cannot do them. It's like playing with two magnets. If you've ever put the opposite ends of magnets together, there is a spiritual condition between the sides. Yah's power demands that they not come together. You can't see what it is that holds them apart. But come on, that's the same spiritual condition. You can lie and say that your Yah is all that you want. Yah knows everyone that are his. Does that make sense? I know it makes sense because Yah spoke those words. So I'm not going to debate and challenge Yah's word. Listen to this. This is Psalm 78:1. I want you to hear how he speaks. I love the beauty of Yah's Torah because of the poetic way in which he allowed the authors. Remember what the book says. It is given by inspiration of Yahweh. So now Yah was so beautifully inspired to create you that then he put that poetic talent upon his messengers to go back and to describe how Yah feels about Yisrael. And we don't even take delight in that. I want you to hear what he says. He says, listen to this now. Give ear, O my people, to my Torah. He says, listen to my Torah. Give ear to my law. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. Now that one word is going to come up all day today. Word. There are several Hebraic words that describe words, sometimes in the plural sense, sometimes in the spoken sense, sometimes in the sense of commandment, sometimes in the sense of the power to create. And I want you to understand that one, that word, debar. Yah is the only one who has the power to create. That's how he could say, let there be, and it was. That within and of itself was the word of Yahweh. And that was free of imperfections. Then what makes you think that the very utterance of all things that we are to abide by could be any different? His word is free of all imperfections. If there's any problems anywhere in the face of this earth, in the world, then it is within men. We're not going to go blaming the word of Yah. We're not even going to let you get away with that. You hear what I say? People will go, they'll look, and they'll, you know, the strangest thing that happens when you preach these messages of Yah and you do the best you can, people will go on board. They'll rate the messages. You get likes. You get dislikes. I'll try not to even look at that. Think about that. Somebody preach the word of Yah as best they can, according to the ability that Yah gives them to utter it. And you go on and you click, I don't like that. You're stupid. I want you to understand the depth of that. Yah does not give a damn what you like. If it's truth, you're going to stand and give an account of that. Makes no difference who you are now. Now, if we like the word of Yah, a like is not even necessary. One likes it, they like it, to let you know I am in agreement with that. But let me tell you what happens when we like the word of Yah. We're going to abide by it. We're going to study that. We're going to lock that in. Do you hear me? When we like the word of Yah, he knows the likes. Because the likes are going to be perfect doers of the Torah. You hear me? People got to be taught that, man. All over the face of this earth, damn near every contraption that has been invented by man, somehow, some way, it comes right back around, has a negative impact. Come on, man. That's why when these things are invented by man, they got to be used to the honor of Almighty Yah. That's what's got to be done, man. Come on, man. Somebody invented paper, they start writing things down. Somebody invented the camera, they start shooting pictures of things. But for long, they take the pictures and shoot pictures of things you shouldn't even be looking at. See how every time something is invented for a positive purpose, here comes wickedness behind it. So it's the same thing with this. These things like the internet and YouTube and things, now that they're created and all manner of filth can be beamed and seen and shown around the world, then beam and show the word of Yah around the world. That's what you do. You tell family and friends, hey man, get up off that Playboy channel. Here's something for you. Here are people preaching the word of Yah. Let's look at that. They don't want a man to say that. They get afraid. That's how people do me all the time, because I don't play with people. I'm at a stage in my life, I ain't got time to play. Come on, we're not going to argue. We're not going to debate the word. I'm going to show you what the word says, and you'll know whether or not after a while I'm going to continue that conversation. I don't believe in that. You'll waste time. People like to take their dialogue and their wicked words and to continue on to produce more and more wickedness in trying to debate the word of Yah. People talk to me all the time and they have this trick question.
Elder, what is your opinion of this, that, and the other?
And I always have the same answer. And I say boldly, I look them in their face and I say, as a messenger of Yah, I don't have a right to an opinion. So don't ask me that. I don't have a right to an opinion on Yah's word. Who am I to formulate an opinion and an analysis of what Yah said? My duty is to obey. Do you hear me? What is your duty? To obey. Yah is the commander in chief. People, they got to dissect the word. They got to exegete the word. They got to create a commentary. I'll beat them over their heads with their commentary. I don't believe in that. Who are you comment on something? I mean that. Look, I'll throw the book at him. I'll bust your head with it. You take that one. He says, I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, meaning I'll say some things that are so deep, so plain, so in depth, you won't even comprehend it. Come on, man. Which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. See, that's what that's the historic record of the fathers. You got to teach this thing to your babies, man. You got to teach this in a way where your babies come up in Yahshua and they understand and they take a delight in knowing that we are the most precious commodity on this earth, man. Yah takes great delight in Yisrael. He says that you are a peculiar treasure unto him. Come on, man. You hear what I say? He says you are a peculiar treasure. Come on. We don't even take delight in that. We will not hide them from their children. You hear that? Showing to the generations to come the praises of Yahweh and his strength. I like that part right there. And his strength. They don't understand that Yah gave those same attributes unto man. The attributes of strength. He gave that unto men. You watch the men today. Oh, I don't feel well. Because you're not serving Yah as thoroughly as you ought to. Come on, we got to stand now. Come on, men, act like little boys. We're looking at the word of Yah from a perspective now that the world will get angry about. I'm going to show you something. Listen to me on this one, you all. Listen close. I'm going to show you the power of Yah's word. As the time moves on, it's going to anger. It's going to incense. It's going to incite violence such so that they will kill over the word of Yahweh. To be ready for that. Come on now. Many people cannot even hold their position in the midst of the discussion. So how are they going to hold their position in the midst of tribulation when they demand that you not worship, that you not preach and not teach in that name at all? Come on, man. See, we talk too much as a people. That's what we do. We talk too much. Listen to verse 5. For he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel. Listen, I want y'all to hear this point. Black and white people are like two drunks staggering out of a bar at 2 a.m. in the morning. They're both so drunk that neither one can now make it without the other. You hear what I say? He gives his word and his understanding to one who then went into captivity. But then he says that I was found by a people who sought not after me. And as you were in captivity, they read, they studied, and they understood. And they said, this is great stuff. So then they latched on to it. And they began to study in such a way that they created things that you did not create, that you did not have a need for. But yet, because they had a need for it, it now becomes an aid and a tool for you and I. See, things like concordance, scriptural dictionaries. These are things that people invented to aid themselves in the study of you and your language and your culture. And those are not bad things. So that now one has the Ruach that followed them, that led them, because he spoke unto them, and the other sought after it, so that the two came together. He's got to break down the middle wall of partition at his appointed time. But the two are like drunks, one on the right and one on the left. And as long as they're walking and they're leaning on each other, they both stand. But if one stops walking in step with the other, one falls that way and the other falls that way. Are you understanding that? So when we say to the people of Yah, he commanded a testimony, and somebody picked this up, somebody read those scrolls, somebody studied that, somebody paid attention to every detail, just as Proverbs 30:5 says, and they took those words and they studied every aspect of it and put it in a dictionary. Put it in a concordance so that today you can pick it up and go back as best you can, as Yah will allow, to understand the language of your forefathers, which changes, which gets intense, which gets deeper, which gets more enriching and becomes more enlightening, so that one grows in the Ruach of Almighty Yah. You understanding this? Come on, man. That's why Yah's people have to study. You got to just shut up and study, man. And when you get with the messengers of Yah and you hear these things and you learn and you understand these things, then we have to be able to do just that. Got to be able to walk in Yah's word and take delight. I want you to hear this. He says, for he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel. Every time you look in the dynamic of a concordance, I want you to see something. You will trace this word testimony, or iduth in the Hebraic language. Testimony. And you'll find something interesting about that word. What you're going to find is that every time you see that word testimony, it traces right back to something that Yahweh has said. He established a testimony in Jacob. So if Yahweh established a testimony in Jacob, come on now. The topic of today's message is right in line with the testimony. For the word of Yahweh is free of all imperfection. Is that making sense, Yisrael? So he says, which he commanded our fathers. That's another word for word now. Commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children. Do you hear that, daddies? Do you hear that, papa? You're supposed to teach this to your children. Teach them. The scripture says the time will come and they will ask, what do you mean by all this great law? What do you mean by these stones? What do these things? He says you'd have to teach them what these things symbolize. Come on. Even this very day, the Shabbat, he says he gave it unto us to be a sign between him and the children of Israel forever. This is the day. This is the worship day. It's not tomorrow. They're going to argue with you. They're going to jump up tomorrow. They'll go to church. They'll listen to him stand there and lie and pontificate. He doesn't even, look, most of those preachers today are in a 50-50 dilemma. Let's throw this out there right now. Get it out the way. Most of them are in a 50-50 dilemma. 50% of what they say, they do not understand it. The other 50%, They don't believe it themselves. So you all better study behind any man that stands up and preaches. You better open the book behind the man. Check for yourselves, because he's not going to stand there in judgment day for you. You're going to stand there for yourself. See, people don't like a no-nonsense messenger of Yah. They want a clown. They want somebody to make them laugh, to make them feel good, so that they can giggle. But a man of Yah that looks at the severity of Yah's word and the condition of this planet and says, I won't play before Yah. This is so serious, we do not want to make a mistake. They don't like that, because the way of Yah is so straight. Come on now. You go back into the lost books, he tells Jezebel, he says that the way is so plain that you're not going to walk side by side with somebody. The way is straight and narrow so that only one man can walk on that path, which means you got to walk it for yourself. This is why HaMashiach said, enter in at the straight gate. For straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life. And then he stops and says, and few there be that find. See, people are looking for big, grand numbers in any of the assemblies, wherever they go. They go to a church, there's 300-400 people, 500-600. People are excited by that. All you have is 400-600 devils. That's all you got. Come on now. They got to go to the biggest church in town. So then you got the biggest gang of devils. So, and there's no more room there. They go to the second biggest church. So then you got the second biggest gang of devils. There's no more room there. Then they go to the third. And it goes on and on ad infinitum. Isn't that interesting? I use a Latin term. Let's be clear on that. So he says that the generation to come might know them. See, this is the point of origin here. Verse 5, he established a testimony. This is the established purpose here. He has a point of origin, and then he gives an established purpose. And the established purpose is that the generation to come might know them, even the children which should be born, who should arise and declare them unto their children. You hear that? That's what's got to happen. Let me show you how y'all work that out. Let's do this right now. Let's go to Isaiah 59, 20 and 21. Let's tie it all in and keep it right consistent with the central theme of today's message, that the word of Yahweh is completely free of imperfections. I want to tell you all, man. It is a command of Yah that you give your children, and you go back and look at this real close. It is a command of Yah that you give your children his perfect Torah. And you should give your children scriptural name, pull them names right out of the book so that they live up to the aspect and the dynamic of that name. Every time you utter their name, that spirit upon them is activated. You hear what I say? Stop calling your children boo-boo, muk muk, and all this stupid stuff, and then you wonder why he's in prison. Teach him the truth of Yah's word and pronounce those Kodesh names so that they live up to it like the men of Yah, like the sons and daughters of Yahshua. Do you hear what I say? Come on, man. The world get offended when you say, we don't give a damn about your culture. And I'm not saying that in a sense of profanity. When you let the world know, we don't care about your culture, that's none of our concern. As for me and my household, we're going to serve Yahweh all the days of our life. When you tell the world that, they get offended. They get mad. They want to impose their wicked, sinful culture upon you. They're trying to impose it on you now. Don't sleep on this LGBT, whatever it is, and begging lettuce, tomatoes. I don't even know what the letters stand for. It'll make no difference to me. Don't be confused by them. We stand back today and we let them push it through, and we say, oh, well, it's all right. It's not all right. And we're not going to buy into that. You let that foolishness go on any amount of time, you know what will happen? It'll be the end of humanity. Perfect trick of Satan. And people sit back and, oh, well. There's no oh, well. It's not well. I want you to hear this. Isaiah 59, 20, 21. Listen to this now. He says, and the Redeemer shall come to Zion, and unto them that turn from transgression in Yaakov. You hear that? A Redeemer is coming. But you have to turn from your transgression is a direct overstepping the boundaries between right and wrong. Yah says, don't do this, don't do that. We go right ahead and step over that. You have transgressed. You've overstepped that boundary. You hear what I say? Now, it's funny, you can transgress this man's law. He's going to come down on you. Go sliding through that light with the police sitting right there at the corner. Go on through that red light. Don't pay it no mind. Don't even tap the brake. Just keep on moving. See if he don't come down on you because you have transgressed their law. So the hypocrites today say, well, you don't have to keep the law. The law, that was way back then. Why do they have some of the same laws on their book today? Now, it's interesting, you don't have to keep Yah's law, but you can keep their law, which they try to make mirror image his law. How hypocritical is that? The word of Yahweh is free from all imperfections. And they don't even want you reasoning like that. We don't think, man. Listen to this. The Redeemer shall come and receive them that turn from transgression, says Yahweh. You hear that? Those words, saith Yahweh. But I like this part. Yahweh speaks for himself. He says, as for me, this is my covenant with them. My ruach that is upon you, and my words, wait a minute. Today's message is that the word of Yahweh is perfectly free of imperfections. So what does he say? My ruach, or my spirit that is upon you, and my words, listen, which I have put in your mouth. Whoa now. My words, which I have put in your mouth, shall not depart out of your mouth, nor out of the mouth of your seed, nor out of the mouth of your seed's seed, says Yahweh. From henceforth and forever. If you are the sons and daughters of the prophets, and you seek the Ruach of Yah, and you strive to abide by the Torah of Yah, it's there. It is within. Yaakov was a tome man. He was complete. All that was required to obey Abba Yah, it was within him. That the man of Yahweh may be perfect, thoroughly furnished. It's in this book. You hear what I say? In the world, they think that, well, man wrote the Bible. Well, man tampered with the Bible. I had one brother give us probably the dumbest answer I've ever heard in the history of my life on this earth. He told us he didn't believe in the Bible. He said the Bible was ancient African wisdom made up by the white man. We were standing in the local bookstore here. I said, brother, I should push you down them steps right now. Saying something so stupid. They have never in the history of their existence on the face of this earth. And I say this before the camera. You have never in the history of your existence on the face of the earth come up with any type of literature that will ever come close to the dynamic of Almighty Yah's word. And you never will. Let's be clear on that. These are the words of Yahweh. No other book, nowhere in the history of this earth, has commanded the type of attention that the scriptures of Yahweh has commanded among all men. No other book has done that. You mean to tell me ain't nothing to it? You can do a simple comparative analysis in that. Come on. There are people on this earth that study everything in great detail. Things that are stupid and dumb and meaningless unto them, they pay it no mind. Do you see them translating Batman comic books and studying them and holding them for hundreds of years and translating them to every nation of the world? That's stupid to them. Somebody's making a profit off of it, but overall, they're not studying that. Do you see them translating and transcribing Bugs Bunny and Daffy and Donald Duck? That's stupid to them. It's meaningless to them, though someone's making money off of that. But when it comes to the word of Yahweh, the nations and the powers that be behind closed doors, they study this book. They watch this book and they study the dynamic of world power because they're watching and witnessing the end times and the unfolding of prophecy of Yah's word. So I'm not going to be disturbed by them. He said to his nation, my word shall not depart out of your mouth. Out of the mouth of your seed. Why would I sit up and let somebody who didn't study the book for 10 or 20, 30 years, now you're going to come and tell me, but in all your studies, one thing was missing. The landing of the Ruach upon your vessel. Come on now. Let's not be afraid to acknowledge this now. There are some men. Hear me well on this. There are some men in this earth that truly do know and understand specific things in the word. yet all at the same time, they don't have his precious Ruach. Do you hear me? Everybody all right? I know you're going to be. So Yah's people have to see that. Let me do this. Let me go right back. I want to finish something here in 78. I want you to hear this. Verse 6. He said that the generations to come might know them, even the children which should be born, who should arise after them and declare them to their children, that they might set their hope in Yahweh. You hear that? You have to set your hope in Yahweh and not forget the works of Yahweh, but keep his commandments. You hear that? Don't forget his works, but keep his commandments. Don't forget his works, but keep his commandments. And might not be as their fathers. Uh-oh. People don't like me to talk about their parents now, especially their mother. Boys get real upset and talk about their mama. He says, and might not be as their fathers, a stubborn and a rebellious generation. So don't do that. You hear what I say? Don't be stubborn. Don't be rebellious. Don't rebel against the word of Yah. Receive it. A stubborn and rebellious generation that set not their heart aright, and whose Ruach or spirit was not steadfast with you. That's our fundamental problem, you all. Israel, that's our fundamental problem. We are with Yahweh when it is convenient to do so. But once the inconvenience sets in, instead of knuckling under, instead of digging in, instead of knuckling up, we fold like a house of cards. We got to remain steadfast with Yahweh. Do you hear me, Israel? Yah's word is perfectly free of imperfection. Then all that he has pledged and all that he has promised unto Israel, he's going to do it. Probably one of the most beautiful aspects of Israel in its relationship with Yahweh is when he gave you his all. This is deep now. He gave you his word. I want you all to hear this. He gave you his word. And then he sent his word. And then only that word, only that lamb, only that Mashiach can open the scroll. Only that Mashiach can open the understanding of our mind that we fully receive it and enact the things that are in this book. It's a beautiful love story there. You hear what I say? You got some that's teaching. They mouth off. They're against Hamashiach. They don't accept this. They don't accept. You have not read the book, my young friend. The book says that days should speak and years should teach wisdom. You hear what I say? Come on, little brothers. I know now they're locking us up nationwide sometimes for things that we didn't do. But come on, let's be realistic now. Sometimes these are things that we have done. Yah says by way of the messenger of Ezekiel that we were not keeping the Torah of Yah, neither were we obeying the laws of the Gentiles. Come on. You know, you got to a point, you are bad people when you won't obey Yahweh and go into captivity and won't even obey your captors. You know, you are tough, rough people. And I don't mean that in the sense of something grand. So we wonder why we suffer the way that we suffer. You didn't suffer the way that lamb did. Be clear on that. Can I move on? Let's do that. The word says that it is given by inspiration of Yah. That's what the word says. The word was given exclusively. I'll prove that. Let's do this. Let's go to Psalm 68:11. Right there, one little verse. Look at this. Yahweh gave the word. Ah! Yahweh gave the word. Great was the company of those that published it. Ah, you hear that? It's an honor to be in the presence of the messengers of Almighty Yah. He says, great was the company of those that published it. It's an honor to be in the presence of them. Come on, man. You read the book of Hanak, you read real close, man. Come on, man. He was a man that was so worn down by the transgressions of the people that he cut off. Come out, he'd preach and teach. Broke that thing down once a week, once a month, once a year. Until Yah took him. But he was a great man in Yah. And Yah says that his testimony was given and formulated that he might be a testimony unto all generations of the earth. That's powerful, man. Yahweh gave the word, and great was the company of those who made it public. Everybody can't do that today. Come on, man. These old prosperity preachers, these little effeminate men, these little secret closet queens. I'm calling it out as it is, man. Don't be looking at me like you're shocked that I'm saying that. Be shocked that they're doing that. Be shocked that the people, they go along with that. They like that. Then when the essence of a man stands up and say, hey, you're not going to have that. All of a sudden, he's wrong. He's perfectly right. He's perfectly right. Man, we don't know. David, in his relationship with Almighty Yahweh, acknowledged his works as clean. I want you to hear that. David acknowledged his works as clean now. But only according to Yahweh's definition of clean. You listening to me on that? Let me go get that. Let's do this. Let's go to 2 Samuel 22. I'm going to show you something. We need to really look at that. I'll say it again. David acknowledged his own works. He acknowledged his works as clean, but only clean according to Yahweh's definition alone. So then Yahweh declares his own righteousness, and all of that is true. 2 Samuel 22, 21. Yahweh rewarded me according to my righteousness. You hear that? According to the cleanness of my hands hath he recompensed me. You hear that? See, people, they like to talk about Dawid's sin, his transgression. They always like to go find that. Say, well, you got something less than Dawid? Let's talk about it. The book says, for all have sinned and come short. We have fallen short. So he says, for I have kept thy ways of Yahweh, and have not wickedly departed from my mighty one, from my creator, from my maker. Notice he says, have not wickedly departed. That's why I keep telling you all, it's imperative that you keep the law of Yahweh. Don't wickedly depart. Come on, man. People get offended when I say the things that I say, especially sometimes in the midst of these little silly conversations that we have. A lot of times, people are not looking to have a conversation to clean up their sins. They're looking to have a conversation to have you validate what they've transgressed. I'm not going to validate you in that. Come on. Brother, want to talk about the need to have two wives? Show me that in the book, friend.
You know, we need to talk about the need to have.
No, we don't. I don't need to talk about the need to have two wives. I need to talk about the need to have the one that y'all blessed me with. That's the need. I talk about that. Yah says he finds a wife, he is a gift from Yah. Notice, he says wife. He didn't say wives, my dear. Again, Yahweh's word. Free of imperfections. So now, all of a sudden, Yah slipped up on that point. He meant to leave, put an S at the word. Come on, little brothers, you're not thinking, man. You're thinking way below the belt buckle. Truth be told, you're thinking out of your toenail. You need to check yourself on that level. Look at Dawid, because when he transgressed, that's the first thing he did. He had to go back and to repent, my friend. And Yah paid him for that. Come on now, let's not get this thing twisted and distorted. He paid him for that. That trouble never departed from out of Dawid's house. Let's be clear on that. See, we got to understand now. Yah says, I will visit the iniquities of the fathers upon the children. He says, unto the third and the fourth generation of them who hate me. You know you're going to have some run to the book.
Well, it also says that children should not die for the sins of the father.
Shut your mouth. Yah has the right to change his mind and to conduct this thing the way that he chooses to. Again, it's in the book. It says, our Abba is in the heavens. He hath done whatsoever he pleased. I told you all. Yah's got an answer for everybody. I don't care how smart you think you are. You can be a smart aleck or you can be a dumb one. He has an answer for everything you're thinking before you even think it up. It's wonderful to serve a mighty one like that. It is wonderful to serve the only one. See, this is the relationship that Israel has to develop. They have to come to a point where we understand that there is no other alternative to Yahweh. And when you come to that point, you can take delight in serving Yah. You hear what I say? People go out and they serve these different gods. When these gods don't suit the need that they need, they jump ship. There's another god. They'll go to that one. You hear what I'm saying? Come on, man. Sometimes we do. Look, let me give you a good example of that right here, right now. You ready for this? they'll use this word. We got to get this word out of our vocabulary. Good. Good is a German word that's associated with God. Good God. The two, they always use them in the same sentence. Then people will turn right around. They want to go do something. And whatever it is that they want to go do, they want to be, quote unquote, blessed in the work. So then they'll tell you, send a specific God to them. They'll say, wish me luck. You didn't know that, did you? Good luck. It's a God. See how Shaitan has infused things in the word of Yah? But that's what the Ruach is for. That's what the spirit of Yahweh is for. To teach you and to open your understanding and to show you when there's even error in things that man has mistranslated. You hear me? Come on, man. Sometimes people will go out, they'll play the lottery. They'll hit the lottery and they'll win in different things. And people will say, he had good fortune. It's a God. So Yah says, right here, you shall have no gods before me. So then when you start teaching Israel, listen, listen, listen. There are things, there are words in our vocabulary on a day-by-day basis that actually has us slipping up and calling on things that Yah hates. So a lot of times people don't want to let things like that go. They don't want to learn things like that. They don't even want to hear it. They try to unhear it. Let me tell you something about Yahweh's word. You're never going to unhear what you heard. You might have forgotten it, but you are not going to unhear what you heard, which means you'll be responsible. People don't know that. You'll be held responsible. Y'all all right? He says, for all his judgments were before me. And as for his statutes, I did not depart from them. I was also upright before him. I have kept myself from mine iniquity. Notice now, he acknowledged his iniquity. Then when he realized what it was, he acknowledged it. He says, I kept myself from it. See, people today, they declare their own righteousness. We have no righteousness to declare. The scripture says that it is Yahweh Sekinu. Him, he, Yahweh, our righteousness. That's what the book says. But people don't want to hear that. For this cause, listen to what David says. For this cause, Yahweh have recompensed me according to my righteousness, according to my cleanness in his eyesight. I told you all. I told you, David acknowledged his righteousness, but he acknowledged it according to Yahweh's definition. Look at the verse carefully, right there, verse 25. He acknowledged all that, but according to Yahweh's definition, not King David or Dawid, not his own definition. Make sense? He comes back later. He writes this down for us in the 119th Psalm and the 142nd verse. He wrote it down. He said plainly concerning Yahweh, your righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and your Torah is the truth. See how the word of Yah continuously bears record and witness of itself? Come on, the messengers, they're not going to study like that. They're not going to go look in the word of Yah and try to go that deep. And I say this is elementary teaching here. This is pre-K. So you know good and well, they're not going to go delve into the depths and the deeper mysteries of Almighty Yah's word, because he's not going to give it unto them. Come on, he's not going to do that. I don't trust no man. You riding around in Bentleys and Rolls Royces and living in 30-room homes and all this. Come on, man. You can't possibly walk throughout the duration of that house in the course of your day. There are rooms that collect dust and dirt that you cannot go into. You need maids and all these things. And people say, well, he wants us to be wealthy. Well, why did you go into captivity then if he wants you to be so wealthy? You transgress. The scripture says that you went into captivity. Let me see if I got this straight, wealthy man. It says you went into captivity, naked and bare, with your buttocks uncovered, to the shame of Egypt. That's what the book said. Now I got a question. If you went into captivity like that, naked and bare, and your butt was uncovered, where was your wallet? Where was your ATM card? Never mind. Let me leave that alone for somebody to find a space to put it. Come on now. Where were the diamonds? The gold? Where was the Rolls Royce? Did you jump in your Rolls naked and bare? Come on, man. Y'all took all that from Yisrael because they would not obey. So today we go, we chase the wealth of the world. And sometimes when we acquire it, come on, Shaitan has power. He can bless. And he can deceive. So then a lot of times people get blessed, they get to say, oh, he's blessing me. He's blessing me. You know, nothing in his word, but he's blessing you. And they don't like to hear messengers teach like this. They don't want to hear that. They don't want to hear that. Come on, man. Let's do this real quick. Y'all all right? Let's go back. Let's look at the messengers of Yahweh. Let's go to Jeremiah. The book of Jeremiah, the second chapter. You ain't got to go that far into the book. I'll make it real easy today. Jeremiah 2. I'll start right at the third verse. I want you to hear this. Yisrael was Kodesh unto Yahweh. And the first fruits of his increase. You hear that? Israel was a, if you use the word for sake of that, holy nation. It was Kodesh. The first fruits of his increase. All that devour him shall offend. You hear that? You touch Israel, you have offended Yahweh. He's coming after you. He's coming for you. All that devour him shall offend. Evil shall come upon them, says Yahweh. Hear ye the word of Yahweh, O house of Jacob, and all the families of the house of Israel. You hear what he says, do? Hear the word. That was the first commandment Yahweh gave to Israel. Shema, O Israel. This is the first command. Hear. Shut your mouth and listen. If you could just get the people to sit down and shut up. If you could just get them to sit down and listen. Today, everybody's a teacher. Everybody. Come on, man. But people get offended. People get afraid. People get hurt. They get disgraced when the messenger of Yah commands that people just shut their mouths. Come on, man. You're in an era of time now to save some people. You're going to have to rebuke them. People don't like that. Don't talk to me like that. Well, we can always let you go till judgment day. I don't want to see you tell him that. His words will be plain. Depart from me. Ye that work iniquity, I never knew you. So who you want to rebuke? Now, thus saith Yahweh. What iniquities? Listen to the question, Yisrael. What iniquities have your fathers found in me that they are gone far from me? And have walked after vanity and are become vain. Now that's terrible. You say you are what you eat. You also are what you do according to this. You walk after vanity. He said you became vain. That's why I tell people all the time. Why are you letting the job stress you out? Why are you letting the bills? Why are you letting the house stress you out? You become all that. You hate the job. So then you become hateful. Because you start slacking away from Yah, and you start drawing more to the trinkets and the trappings of the world. Keep your faith in Yahweh. Stand firm. When Yah is with you, he is always still more than the entire world when it turns against you. We're going to get to a point. We know that. I can stand here and say that all day. You've got to come to that understanding for yourself. Do you hear me, Yisrael? So when somebody goes to teach us that, we take offense to that. Come on. What iniquities have your fathers found in me that they're gone far from me and have walked after vanity and are become vain? Neither did they say, where is Yahweh that brought us up out of the land of Mizraim? People don't ask for Yahweh today. A lot of that stupid stuff you see out there on the internet, people are trying to push Yahweh away. You can in your mind push all you want, but when he pushes back, I'm telling you right now, he's going to win. You hear me? They say, they don't say, where is Yahweh that led us through the wilderness, through a land of deserts and pits, and through a land of drought and of the shadow of death, through a land that no man passed through and where no man even dwelt. They don't ask, where was Yahweh? They don't ask today, where is Yahweh? And I brought you into a plentiful country to eat the fruit thereof and the goodness thereof, or the tovness thereof. But when you entered, you defiled my land. That sounds like us. You know who they were. Don't act like you don't know the people of the book. Same cultural characteristics today follow you. We ain't gonna act that stupid now. Now, sometimes you know a thing. You might be in a predicament where you just don't say nothing. You know, you just don't say nothing. This one, I'm situated where, no, this is going to be said. Your characteristics are with you. It is upon you. You know who you are. That's why I'm at that predicament in my life. I ain't going to stand around arguing with nobody now saying that they me. I'm not going to stand here and argue with you while you're pretending to be me. If you're pretending to be me, then who am I? When I wake to the knowledge of, that ain't even an argument. I'll leave you standing there lying, because the truth of the matter is, now we're delving into the realms of insanity. And you start delving into the realms of insanity with identity theft, which is the oldest crime on the face of this earth. Let's get down to it now. You steal the identity of a nation. That's an old crime. It's a pathology. It is a demonic seed. That is a liar. And this is why Yah says, liar shall not tarry in my sight. See, people don't like when you wake up to the knowledge of self. Come on now. I don't give a damn that they get mad when they hear me say this. Let's be perfectly clear on one thing. You can get mad and offended about this all you want. These are Yahweh's rules. And your madness and your offense taking isn't going to do one thing to alter this. Yah says in his word, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. So you do well, baby, to keep your head low and do what Yisrael must do. You keep that commandment of Yah, because this is the whole duty of man. You hear what I say? See, people don't like that. They want to do their own thing and bring their own dirty, damnable rules to Yahweh. He's not having that. Don't think because he sat back and let it go now that he's going to be weak and wimpy like that. Don't think like that. Because when he rises up, I'm telling you, he's going to snap off on this earth like something we've never seen. People don't know the judgments of Yah. They don't go through the book to see the thing. He says in the word that the slain of Yahweh at that day shall be from one end of the earth until the other end of the earth. They shall not be gathered, nor buried, nor lamented. He's going to put the undertaker out of business. He's going to put the first responders out of business. He's going to put the doctors and the mourners out of business, because he's not playing in the earth. Why then should the messengers of Yah deliver the word playing? No time for no damn jokes. Tell the people of Yah to get in a hurry. He said, write the vision and make it plain upon tablets so that he that reads may run. Where are you going to run outside of Yahshua HaMashiach? Where are you going to run to? There is no hiding place. You got to let people know, I didn't come to play. We come to deliver Yah's word. And we let the people of the world know, Yah gave us a command. He gave us a charge. And your command and your charge, you are to guard this. This is a specific way of life. I listened to a speech of John Kennedy the other day. He was telling the people, it does not matter if we're going to save the country, if we don't save our values with it. Saving the country does us no good. I said to myself, now, isn't that profound? If Yah's people are not going to save the culture, the values, the tradition, the way of life that Yah gives unto Israel, we're wasting time. This is not a religion. This is your way of life. Yah knows how he wants his people to live. There's some wonderful things in Yah's Torah now. I'm going to tell you now. Some things that extend life. There are things that extend blessing. There are things that bless a household. There are things that bless the mama. There are things that bless the babies. There are things that bless the daddy. All that. There are things that bless the whole family. Because he knew what he was doing. He knows all things. So then what he said, he meant it. And his word is free from imperfection. So all them little boys out there, I don't care if they're 79, you little boy. Anytime you're trying to dissect the word of Yah and find fault with Yah's word, you're out of your mind. People say, well, that's King James. That's what the little man told me. I said, well, I don't know why you're so hung up on the King James. I said, well, my dear friend, I have about 27 different versions now. Come on, which one you want me to use? He said, well, I'm a student. I'm just used to talking. I said, well, did you do that in daycare? Did you do that in elementary school? Did you go there and tell the teacher what time you were going to break the cookies and eat and drink the milk? No. Then sit down and shut up if you're a student. Shut your damn mouth. I don't play with people like that. Everybody today, they think they're going to walk in the mouths of the messengers. That's because the messengers, they don't draw out the sword like they ought to. He tells them in the book of Romia, he says, he bears not the sword in vain. Yahweh's word is his sword. And it says that it's sharper than any two-edged sword. People don't like that word when that word starts cutting too close to them. I've been in that one too. Come on, I was a young man. Tried to stray, tried to get out there, tried to see what was out there in the world. My daddy get up and preach on the very things me and my homeboys did. And he wasn't even there. I said to myself, how in the world he know that? And when you're young and your mind is wicked, rather than you think Yah revealed it, you just get mad with the speaker. You don't realize, Yah give him that to say because he's talking directly to you. Get right. You hear what I say? That's what the word does. If you find the word of Yah cutting you, the word might not be cutting you for sake of destroying you. You may be one of the ones that he's had mercy upon, that you can hear that you may be given space to get right. We're like a bunch of spoiled babies and monkeys. We want to have our way. So then we want the men to speak smooth things to us. And when it ain't smooth, we get mad. I don't like him. Ain't going back there no more. Good! Don't come back. That's more room for the righteous. One more seat for someone that's driving. People say, man, that's tough. That's the way it is. Ain't no bogarting and walking up in Yah's kingdom. Gangsterism in Yah's kingdom. You're going to obey Yah or you're going to get gone. That's the only rule. You obey him or get on down the road. And trust me, the road ain't pretty. He says it's wide. He says many go in that way. And he's going to burn them all. Look at this 8th verse here. The priest said not. Where is Yahweh? The priest didn't even ask. And they that handled the Torah knew me not. Didn't I tell y'all some of them preachers are liars? 50% of what they say, they don't understand. The other 50%, they don't believe it themselves. If you don't believe it, you certainly don't know Yahweh. Come on now. Here Yah has a messenger saying, he's calling them out. The pastors also transgressed against me. And the prophets prophesied by the Lord. Call it out. Baal, the Lord. And walked after things that do not profit. But I want you to look at that word there. Prophet. Because that's all that they're after. A prophet. A buck. The dollar bill. You know, sometimes people are just out of their mind. They don't even know who they're worshiping. They're after the money. Bunch of little dead men on the money. They were dead when they were alive. And everybody up and on. Oh, they're going to put Harriet Tubman under 20. Well, there's a rule for this society. I know y'all going to get offended, but so what? There's a rule for this society. Check the record. Anytime the black man get it, it's over with for it anyway. Check the rap. Every time they get Hollywood's movies, whenever the black man president, it's the end of the world. They give you drugs and everything else, and all hell break loose. It's the end of your communities. They let you drive big, expensive cars. Now, it's the end of the world. Now, suddenly, now they're going to put your face on the money. They probably give me a collapse the thing. Anytime you get it, it's the end. Now, tell me I'm lying. Now, if you white folk that's listening, I understand. You Caucasian listeners, I understand. I just want to say, I want to be clear now. I'm not going to bite my tongue. Don't get upset. Just know for real, your fathers have done these things. And when you don't want anybody to bring these things up, then you're actively involved in a cover-up. You cannot cover up the sin. There is only one that can cover up our sins because, see, he is our propitiation for sin. And you're not going to get it covered if you don't turn unto HaMashiach. Come on now. You can get angry all you want. I do not care. He didn't call you to this. This is the one realm where he commanded that Israel go forward and stay. That's why I don't back down off of them. Not on this I won't. Then they'll lie. They have this one beautiful, fanciful lie. Every time you stand up to them, there's one lie that they tell over and over and over. You're a racist. While I'm on it, let's define it. According to all of the data and the research I've read, it makes sense. Racism is only one thing. It's the white world supremacist system, where all the rules are made by people who classify themselves as white. So in the realms and in the areas of education, economics, and your entertainment, in your labor, in your law practices, in your political arena, in your military aspects, in everything you can think of, even down to the manufacture and the development of arms and warfare material, you make all of the rules so that you and people who look like you can always come out on top. So I speak out against that. Suddenly, I'm the racist. But the charge is now on you to find one country with a global system like that, where I've reversed all the rules of everything I just said and have given you permission to go forward and say that. Almighty Yahweh is no respecter of persons. But those that he chose, he just chose who he chose, and it is what it is. You're not going to erase that from Yah's mind when he says that I have engraven you on the palms of my hands. You're not going to erase that. You do well to just humbly acknowledge this is the seed that Yahweh has blessed. The Torah says in Isaiah 61 that all who see them shall acknowledge them, that they are the seed that Yahweh has blessed. So Yah's word rebukes us all. Yah's word chastises, it chastens and corrects us all. Nobody gets away. You're not going to play that supremacist game with me. We're not going for that. Yah says, let me do this. Verse 11. Has a nation changed their gods, which are yet no gods? Have the Chinese dropped their worship of the dragon and all the little silly things? Have they changed that yet? Come on now. Has the African changed all of the different things he worships and all the stuff he's into? Has he changed that yet? Israel. But my people have changed their splendor for that which does not profit. We're the only nation that gave up our mighty one and accepted the mighty ones and the damnable dirty gods of all the nations. You'll find black Baptists, black Muslims, black Christians, black Buddhists. We follow all the religions of all the... You're not even native to that particular part of the world. How'd you get hooked up into that particular religion? This one, that one, into all this stuff, the star worship, the sun, the moon, all these different things. How in the world did you get into all of that? Yeah, isn't there something? Black Mormons. Isn't one of their prophets named Moron or something like that? You all laughing. It's in the book, Moroni. Call it like it is. No, Moron. No, Moron. It's what it is. I've read the book. I read the little dirty book. Prophet named Moron. That right there tells me, shut the book. Be following him, Moron. Satan, play with your mind now. Satan, tell you the truth sometimes, throw it right out there in your face. I'm going to send you a prophet. He's going to be a nutcase. You'll love it. Listen to what Yah says. Be astonished, O ye heavens, at this, and be horribly afraid. Be very desolate, says Yahweh. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and have hewed out pitchers, broken pitchers, can hold no water. Can you imagine that? You strolling across the desert, you ain't got nothing but a pitcher in your hand, hoping you come across a little stream or something where you can get yourself a drink. All along, you ain't paying attention that it's a big hole at the bottom, just as big as the one at the top. Anytime you dip it down and bring it up, take it to your mouth, it's gone fast as you bring it up. That's Yisrael. He says it right here. Come on, man. We procured these things unto ourselves. We brought it upon ourselves, and we don't want nobody to say anything to help us, to bring us out of it, to teach us, to instruct us. We don't want it because the instructions sometimes get a little rough, they get a little harsh, because you got to drop those pagan ways. We don't want to do that. We want to try to like go along with it. There is no going along with it. We got to get right with Yahweh, and we got to get right with him. We got to do it now, or else we're not going to make it. You hear me? Yahweh declares his own righteousness according to his own word. All there is to that. Let's go back. I want to show you something. Let's go to the book of Hosea. Everybody all right? This is a message here. This message don't take long. Cut straight to the point. That's all. Ain't no whole lot of messing around to do. Get in there and deliver Yah's word. Hosea 8, beginning right at 8 in the 8th verse. Listen to how Yah describes Israel. He says, Israel is swallowed up. Now shall they be among the Gentiles, as a vessel wherein there is no pleasure. You hear that? Let's identify. Who's sick and tired of Israel? Who's any more sick and tired of Israel than the Gentiles? No pleasure. They don't take no delight in you. You move into the neighborhood, they move out. Tell me they don't. There's no pleasure in you. They don't delight in you. This is what the book says. Now, it's going to get worse. I'm going to show you what the book, I'm going to show you what it says about you and your jobs and all those. Hey, how about I stop talking? Let's let the word talk. For they are gone up to Assyria. Y'all ready for this? A wild ass alone by himself. See, that's why when I talk to them young men, I put those words in the context sometimes that they can understand. People get shocked because they think you're cursing at them. No, no, no. I told the young brother, I said, man, you need to sit your wild ass down. He looked at me like I was crazy. I said, brother, that's in the book. Look, a wild ass alone by himself. Now, an ass is an animal. But here it is in the book. See how wild we have become before Yah? Look at the comparative analysis he did. For they have gone up to Assyria. Ephraim have hired lovers. Uh-oh. We got to get out now as young men. Got to get club to the topless bar. Got to get there. Yeah, though they have hired among the nations, now will I gather them, and they shall sorrow a little for the burden of the king of princes. Notice now how he says, though they have hired among the nations, you work for them, don't you? You ain't got no whole lot. You have jobs. You have to work for them. You have to go fill out an application. You hire yourself out to them. Pay attention to what the word is saying. He has to gather them. Because Ephraim have made many altars to sin. Altars shall become unto him sin. So we build up all these churches after a while, just building up the churches. Just you build them up just to sin. Come on, they got a new online church hustle. You can go on there, take a test, get a minister's license, go on, set your church up and rip and run. He ain't studied nothing. He just lucked up and passed a dumb test. And people flock to that. Isn't it interesting how the world has a spirit upon it that despises true messengers of Yahweh? But then charlatans and pimps and hookers can preach and they like. I'm going to tell you now, y'all put a spirit on them where they can't do any better. They like that because that's what they are. Same way he says, they that make dumb idols are like unto them. It's the same thing about setting up these false prophets and idolizing them. These men are dumb. They're ignorant. Let's say now, these men and women, because the women are running out there too. They're saying the apostle Shaul said, I suffer not a woman to teach, not to usurp authority over the man. They're saying he said that because he was sexist. Come on now. Listen. We can go right back to the initial opening phase of the book. We can go right back to the book of Leviticus. We can open the book up to the 21st chapter. We can look at the laws and the rules and the regulations for men holding the office of the priesthood. You're going to find it in there at a bare minimum of 60 times where he uses the masculine word. He, him, his, sons. Nowhere does he describe her, she, daughters, women, wives. He describes the conduct of the office of the priesthood. People say, oh, he was just sexist. No, this is warfare. He did not send them to be on the front line in that. You are the purveyor of the nation. What would HaMashiach have been? He come to the world, his mother out preaching. Go in labor, right while she's standing there delivering a message. Y'all knew what he was doing. So the women today, they get offended at that. They get mad. Even women in Israel, they get mad. Yeah, you better check your spirit, sister. He didn't send you to head up the nation like that. And he did not shortchange the sister. He did not make you a remnant. He did not make you a remnant. I'm talking about this carpet, a throw rug. He put you there to walk beside the man, to accentuate the beauty of Yah's creation. That's why he says he made them in his image, male and female. And for the women that have a lot of mouth, let me remind you now, Yah chastised three parties that were involved. Two of them said nothing. Let's be clear on that. People get offended when you tell them things like that. That's why they push so much wicked stuff today, man. Come on, they push that stuff. Let's deal with this now. Because Ephraim has made many altars to sin, altars shall be unto him sin. I have written to him the great things of my Torah, but they were counted as a strange thing. That's how we do the feast days of Yah today. That's how we do the Shabbat today. That's how we do the proper dress code and conduct. We look like this is strange. It's not strange when you come to understand this is what Yahweh said do. The strangeness is when you start looking around at the world. They can go to the church with the itty bitty dresses on, breasts hanging all out, dresses so low cut right down to their navel. And then they wonder why the baby start crying. Baby crying, he think it's time to be fed. And then they don't want nobody to say anything to them about this. Come on now. We got to get this thing in order. Yah says, I gave them the great things of my Torah, and they were counted as a strange thing. Israel today, a lot of times, they're ashamed to keep the Shabbat. They don't want to be seen properly dressed. Come on, you don't make me shame. I shame my entire neighborhood when I come out every Shabbat. Ain't no nothing else. I come out that door every Shabbat at the same time, rain or shine. You're not going to make me feel bad because I keep the Shabbat. I look at you the next day. And say to myself, what a shame. Well, when you cannot tell a people what thus saith Yahweh, because they already have it figured out and have figured out how to edit Yahweh's thoughts, have figured out how to edit his mind, how to edit his code of conduct, that's the people that you're not going to be able to help. You're not going to do anything with them. You hear what I say? You're not going to be able to do a blessed thing with them. Because nobody can tell them anything. Let me show you something in Yah's word. Let's look at Isaiah 28. I'm almost done here, y'all. Bear with me on this. We all right, right? I know we are. This is the day that Yah has made. The song says, let us rejoice and be glad in it. I don't know about you. That's right. I'm glad in it. You don't get me upset because the Shabbat roll around. This is the day I was waiting for since last Monday, last Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Right around Thursday and Friday, I started getting a little more pep in my step. I knew it was the Shabbat. Come on, man. Listen to this. I want you to pick up on how Yah just gives the messengers the ability. Now, remember that scripture we went through in Timothy. It says that all scripture is given by inspiration of Yahweh. He puts that ruach upon those men, and they write, as Yah speaks to their mind, they write down exactly what he says to write. You hear that? This wasn't no see and say, speak and say. This wasn't dragon speaking, all that stupid technological stuff they had today. Yah was inspiring those men. He told them to write this down. Isaiah 28:9, he says, whom shall he teach knowledge? And whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. You see that? You come up in this as babes. See if you don't come up knowledgeable in Yah's word. Come on now. I know some old men. Older men today, man in his 70s. He thought he gonna come here and take over the place. Knew nothing in the book of Yah. Knew nothing. Filthy mind and everything. Say he's a Hebrew. claiming to speak Hebrew and everything. Come on, my dear friend. Let me tell you all something about that. Claiming to speak it and understanding it and obeying it are three different things. A lot of people speak it. Come on, man. People speak French. Does that make them a Frenchman? They taught that in school. I wasn't good at it. Now I know why. Had Spanish too. Wasn't good at that. Now I know why. When we wake up to the knowledge of us being Hebrew and realize we went into captivity and Yah struck at everything, even our language. He took your language. You're not going to obey me. Why would I let you speak my Kodesh words? I'll put you out there in the midst of another nation. I'll speak to you with stammering lips of another tongue. So that now I'll compel you to fight to understand it. Then he says in his word at the appointed time, he says, then shall he turn to the people a pure language at his appointed time. Oh, he's going to restore that. There's no doubt about that. The kingdom message ain't going to be French. The kingdom language, ain't going to be French. Ain't going to be German. It ain't going to be Russian. Ain't going to be Kiswahili. No language upon the face. Yah is going to return the language that he spoke to his people from the very beginning. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept. Precept here, this word, the Hebrew word pakud, it means now that Yah pays strict attention to the order in which he wants a thing done. You notice that? He put the order of the days of the week. They come in that order. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, Shabbat. Did you hear me? He gave one name, Shabbat, Shabbaton, rest, cessation from labor. He pays strict attention to the order that he wants things done in. That's why a lot of times things don't go the way that they should go in our lives, because we don't do anything in any order, man. We get up, eat, then we wash our face, brush our teeth, then wash out, then run out the door. Put shoes on, put the makeup on, in the car, stupid stuff like that. No order. Y'all pay strict attention to the way he wants a thing done. That's why he gave the priesthood the orders and the commands of how to do a thing. Y'all is not the author of confusion. Line upon line, line upon line. But look at this here. Here a little and there a little. Here come a prophet, he writes something down, he falls asleep in Yah. Here come another behind him, 200-300 years later, he pick up and tie directly right back into what that messenger said. Here comes one several hundred years behind the two of them. Pick up, write, tie into what the first and the second said and move on. Here comes 3, 4, 5 after them. And a continuum of the dialogue that Almighty Yah has with Yisrael has not been broken. Why he says here a little and there a little. People don't know that the book connects from Genesis to Revelation, as well as the suppressed books. They don't believe that it all interlocks and overlaps. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people. Look at you today. You're learning it in English now. Now just think, I just told you when I started, these languages, they do no justice. They hold no justice to the beauty of Yah's word in the original language now. I guess I better prove that. Am I correct? Let me do this. Pull this out here. We'll jump in this lost book real quick. Just want to make one point. The people of Yah, they don't know. They don't know his word. His messengers, they had things to say. The messenger says, wherefore, let me entreat you to read this with favor and attention, and pardon us wherein we may seem to have come short of some of the words which we have labored to interpret. For the same things uttered in Hebrew and translated, listen, for the same things uttered in Hebrew and translated into another tongue have not the same force in them. What Yah's people speak in Hebrew? The weight behind it in this filthy English language, this Greek, this Latin, all these different French and German languages. Come on, man. They do not hold a candle to the beauty of Yah's word. For example, he named himself Yahweh. He named himself. If that name means I caused to exist, that's the name he chose for himself. Can nobody come along and tell me, don't call him Yahweh. That means chicken pig. You're stupid, woman. I said that, and I'm not going to back up off of that. You're stupid. Don't bring me some Greek and Latin literature trying to explain a Hebrew construct. If that were the case, he would have spoken to the Greeks and to the Latins, and he would have given it unto them. So now the messenger says, the same things uttered in Hebrew and translated into another tongue have not the same force in them. And not only these things, but the Torah itself and the prophets, notice they say here, and the rest of the books have no small difference when they are spoken in their own language. They don't disagree. Isn't that beautiful? When they're all spoken in their own language, they don't disagree, because then you can look up the words and the meaning. So what was my initial point earlier today? They invented something called the concordance. And by the power of Almighty Yah, you use that thing as a roadmap, as a guide. He allowed it to be done. Come on. Can't say that it's not a valuable tool, my friend. But there's no tool going to be above Almighty Yah when he touches the minds of his people and restores their proper language. See, people get into Yah's business worrying about how he's going to do this, how he's going to do that. And then when you open the book and start showing direct aspects of specific things Yah's going to do for his people, people don't want to believe that.
I don't know about that.
You didn't know about it before it was brought up. And now that you've heard it, you still don't know anything about it. You do well to just be quiet and study. That's what the book says. Study to be quiet, right? You got to tell people something. Shut up, man. Shut up, man. Talk too much. You talk too much. You're yapping. You talk too much. I'm at that point now. I listen to a lot of time and they talk until I get sick of it. And then I shut them down. Because you pick up a lot in their spirit. They got this. They got that. They got this. They got that. Be quiet. Here's what the word says. We're going to solve that problem you got by looking at this. They want it so complex. A lot of time I've talked with many people, they really don't want y'all to solve their problem. They want to discuss the problem and they want to wallow in it. They don't want the problem solved. That's the truth of the matter. They just want to keep yapping about it. That's not therapeutic. If you think that's therapeutic, no, it is not therapeutic. It is unhealthy for you to try to find so much fault in the word of Yah that you then try to reason and tell yourself the word cannot help you in this situation. It helps in all situations. That's what we do. Let's do this. I'm going to start wrapping this up. Let's go to 2 Peter real quick, chapter 1. I'm going to show you something that was said about the word of Yahweh. A lot of times people, they don't believe the things that's written in Yah's word anyway. They think they got it figured out. They think they got it down pat. Nah, this thing here takes time. And that's why he give you a lifetime to study and pay attention. 2 Peter 1:16. I want y'all to pay attention to this. Listen to how the apostle expresses this. He says, for we have not followed cunningly devised fables. Fables. Those are stories where animals are walking and talking in the place of humans. You hear me? It says, we have not followed that. When we made known unto you the power and coming of our Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach. But we were eyewitnesses of his splendor. You hear that? These men were eyewitnesses of it. They saw the power of what he could do, and they recorded it. They wrote it down. Some people, oh, how are they going to write certain stuff down? It wasn't even there. Again, the book says they wrote as the Spirit of Yahweh inspired them. So they didn't always have to be present to write what Yah commanded to say happened. Come on, man. People that wise, you're going to pick the word of Yahweh. You don't even pick the Wall Street Journal apart when they lie. You don't even pick the New York Times apart. They lie. The Washington Post, Time, Newsweek, U.S. News. Well, you don't pick them apart. Now, when it comes to the word of Yah, suddenly you got this level of education that soars through the clouds. Where does that come from? It's a lying spirit, man. For he received from Yahweh the Abba, honor and splendor. And when there came such a voice to him from the excellent majesty, if you use such a word, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. And the voice which came from the Shemayim or from heaven, we heard when we were with him in the Kodesh Mount. So they're saying they heard it. But listen to this. This is where the conversation shifts. We have also a more sure word of prophecy. Again, the word of Yahweh is completely free of imperfections. We have also a more sure word of prophecy. whereunto
you do well
that you take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day emerge and the day star arise in your heart. And you're talking about Lucifer. Let's be clear on that. So now, you in a house that's dark and ain't got no light, and somebody come through with a flashlight, say, hey, well, follow me. That's what Yah's word has done for us. It has opened up the darkness so that we are able to walk in the light. People keep running their mouths. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. You know how some people do. They try to take it and make it mean exactly what they want it to mean. No, the rule is simple. You take the scripture and you let the scripture prove the scripture. That's the rule. It validates and substantiates itself. Even the dummies who translated it into the English language knew that. For the prophecy came not in old time, listen, by the will of man. See, it didn't come because man said, I'm going to write down this prophecy. But Kodesh, men of Yahweh, spake as they were moved by the Ruach HaKodesh. You see how you got this book today? They wrote as he inspired them to write it down. And he also commanded the world, don't touch it. Have respect for it. Do not destroy that. So it's somewhere in this earth. And he has messengers in whose hearts or in their level, in their mind, he has touched them in a way where they're able to deliver the word. It's in here. He puts it in that mind. So many times people today, they think themselves to know and to fully understand or comprehend the thing. They don't have it. Come on, these men sit down and study and wrestle with it and twist up all as they do all the other scriptures and twist it to their own destruction. There are no imperfections in the word of Yahweh. The imperfections are made to appear even before our very minds by ignorant men. You hear what I say? These are men with their commentaries and all these other things. These are ignorant men. They don't understand the real power of Almighty Yahweh and Yahshua. So then, how can they give us any real sense of understanding the wisdom of Yahweh in this matter when they don't even understand Yahweh's word? Come on, Yisrael. I told you that what makes the word of Yahweh so vitally important today that it even causes the wicked to rise up and to slay you because of the word. You hear me? Let's do this. Let's get that. I want to show you where having a knowledge of the word of Yah can cause some to be put to death. It's Yah's will. There's no cause for people to be alarmed now. I don't want to preach. I don't want the word. Not what he's saying. He says, if you lose your life for his name's sake, you shall find it again. I believe that. I don't know about other people. I believe that. Yahweh has all power. If he says he's going to bring those vessels back, then he has that kind of power. They can't do it at Hopkins. They can't do it at Sinai. Ain't nothing in they shock a body. Boom, clear. Next thing you know, he back. Bloop, 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 bloop. They can't keep you here forever. They study. They can take a heart out. Come on, they do heart transplant now. You're pretty much dead. Go on the table, go in, dig in, cut it out, take your heart out, put another heart in. You're no longer a man now. You come on, you some kind of machine, some kind of beast. You something other than what Yah made. Tell me Abraham had a heart transplant. I want to hear you tell me that. Come on, man. We listen to these men. These men call themselves reasoning all over the planet now. They're so wise. Really? Let's go to the book. Once you see this now. Revelation 6, verse 9 through 11. I want you to look at this real carefully. I told you that there was only one that could open the book. I want you to see what he was doing as he was opening these scrolls now, opening these seals. I want you to look at what he was doing. It says in 6, 9, Revelation, and when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of Yahweh. Stop right there. There's a key question that has to be asked. You see, if what we preach is lies and falsehood and garbage, why monitor this? Why study this? Why get angered about it? You hear what I say? If there's nothing to it, leave it alone. But if it's that aggravating, that soul piercing, that gut wrenching, that you cannot stand the word of Yah, so that you rise up and murder the messengers of Yahweh. Look at what the book says. He says, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of Yahweh and for the testimony, holy, which they held. I told you that word testimony, every time it's found in scripture, it goes right back to something that Yahweh has said. So now imagine these men repeating something that Yahweh has said, and it causes them to be put to death. Slain for the word of Yahweh, and it causes them to be put to death. And they cry with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Yahweh, Kodesh and truth, do you not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? See, people get around there, they won't even pray against their enemy. They want the enemy, oh, bless the enemy. I remember here in Baltimore, saw it with my own eyes at the supposed funeral of Freddie Gray. I saw it here. The preacher prayed and he asked, bless them, Father, bless the police officers and their family for the wrong that they did. I said to myself, now listen to this man. That's what he said. Bless the officers and their families for the wrong that they done. Now that's a liar. How are you going to bless the wicked when Yah says that he's angry every day with the wicked? See, we don't know how to pray, man. You don't know. And then you wonder why the enemy gets stronger. Come on, man. Now here, this is the nefesh. These are the souls of those that were already slain. He saw their souls. They went to their graves troubled, crying, asking Yahweh for vengeance. And he says in his word that vengeance is mine. I will repay. Now you understand why some people get mad when they hear a judgment message. They get angry because they don't want to face the reality that I've done wrong and there's a day coming where I have to be paid back. See, I told you, your racial supremacy goes out the window with the word of Yahweh. And white robes were given unto every one of them. You see this here? Now, I can pull it out of the lost books. I'll show you where Yah showed his messenger, where they all had to wait. They were all waiting. He showed them the room where their robes were. He showed them the room where the crowns are laid up. This is why the apostle Shaul said, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the righteous judge, the man, saw into. These preachers don't see that today. They lie. I know my mother's in heaven looking down on me. That ain't what the book says. The book says the dead know not anything. The lost book says that they wait on Yahweh in profound quietness. They're waiting. My mother's looking down on me. I know my daddy's smiling down. No, did he die with the smile on his face? And it was said unto them that they should rest for yet a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were, should be fulfilled. Now, who wants to look at that? Who wants to look up and realize the testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy? You're not a prophet unless you have the testimony of Yahshua, which Yahweh gave him. How are you going to do that without him? And these people are killers? Because the word of Yah torments and aggravates them so much so that that's all they have left to do. So then you tell Yisrael, come out of her, my people. Withdraw yourself psychologically, socially, spiritually, as best you can from this wicked world system. You can't live and breathe and walk and think like them and then think you're serving Yah. Come on now. So now, if the word of Yah is, I'll say it again, so vitally important that it causes the world to kill his messengers, what then are they saying that has upset the world? Come on, man. Considering that the word of Yahweh is free from imperfections, then it's obvious that all sin, transgression, and iniquity, as it is understood and found in this earth, lies exclusively with the entire world, but especially with Israel as a covenanted people, because we knew better. It was given unto us to know, and it was given unto us to go ye therefore and teach all nations. See, Israel knew. The sons and daughters of the prophets, they knew. Let's do this. Let me get this final scripture. I got to get this one here in, because it wouldn't even make any sense. Now, I told you that Yah says they're going to kill some about his word, but Yah comes right back and has the final say-so about his word. Keep on telling people, man. They got to pray that the Ruach open their understanding of this. Let's look at Revelations 22, 18 and 19. I want you to hear this. Yah's going to have the final laugh. They think they got something funny to snicker about. Yah's going to have the final say-so. For I testify, this is Revelation 22, 18. I testify unto every man that hear the words of the prophecy of this scroll. You hear this? If any man shall add unto these things, Yahweh shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. There's a lot of plagues in this book now. So you add unto his word. So you contradicting Yahweh. What did the opening scripture say? Every word of Yahweh is pure. Don't add to it, lest he reprove you and you be found a liar. Now here he's closing it out. He says, don't add to it. If any man shall take away from the words of this scroll, of this prophecy, Yahweh shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the Kodesh city and from the things which are written in this book. See how he's going to get the last say? He's going to have the last say, man. I don't care what the world thinks. I don't care how smart, how wise, or how scholarly they are. There is no wisdom, understanding, or counsel against Yahweh. Therefore, we have no knowledge of anything unless Yah grants it unto us. So every day of your life, you get up, you better toe to Yah for what you have. You breathe in his air, you better toe to Yah for that. You walk on his earth, you better toe to Yah for that. You eat food that he provided for your vessel, you better toe to Yah for that, because the vessel you have is loaned to you. He is self-existent, always has, always will. He does not need you and I to exist, but we definitely need him. So when I say to you that the word of Yah is clear and free of imperfections, then it's up to Yisrael to draw closer to Yahweh and to take great delight in his word. That's what he said, dude. He said, take delight in my Shabbat. That's what he said. He said, call the Shabbat a delight. It's a wonderful day. I tell you all, as I stand here every Shabbat and I teach out of Yah's word, I'm just as enriched receiving the word as you all are. I'm telling you that, man. I labor for this. I wish I didn't have to get out and sling brick and block every day like I do. Man, I studied it, man. We could go far, man. Come on. People got to put their all into Yahshua, because Yah put his all in him. When he gave us the dynamic of Yahshua HaMashiach, man, there's nothing in all the world like him. The song that Yisrael sings, Victory Community always lays that song out. I love to hear that. I play that song so much, man. It says, don't you know there's none like Yahweh? And you hear the sisters echo in the background. They say, yes, I know there's none like him. What's the hold up, Yisrael? The book says that you uproot when you put all your trust in him. That's what it says. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him. You trust that landlord. You trust that employer. You trust that car dealer. You trust everything. But now you out here, you know the Most High. You know the one and only maker of all things in heaven above and in the earth. You know him. And then doubt him. Come on, man. You got to do better than that. Am I correct, Yisrael? See, the people of Yahweh have to just simply search him out. Got to draw closer to Yahweh. The world doesn't want that. Y'all got a minute? Give me this. I'm going to squeeze this in. You got to. People of Yah have no idea of the profoundness of what he's going to do for his people. And all these things which I have said earlier should be before your eyes always, since we are still in the Ruach of the power of our liberty. And further, Yahweh the Most High is also long-suffering to us here, and has shown to us that which comes, and has not concealed that which will happen at the end. Therefore, his judgment exacts his own, and truth of that which is its due. Let us therefore prepare ourselves, that we may possess and not be possessed, that we may hope and not be put to shame, and that we may rest with our fathers and not be punished with our enemies. For the youth of this world has passed away, and the power of creation is already exhausted, and the coming of the time is very near and has passed by, and the pitcher is nearer to the well. So is the ship to the harbor, and the journey to the city, and life to its end. Furthermore, prepare yourself so that when you set sail and ascend from the ship, you may have rest and not be condemned when you have gone away. For behold, Yahweh the Most High will cause all these things to come. There will not be an opportunity to repent anymore, nor a limit to the times, nor a duration of the periods, nor a change to rest, nor an opportunity for prayer, nor sending up a petition, nor giving knowledge, nor giving a haba, nor opportunity of repentance, nor supplicating for offenses, no prayers of the fathers, nor intercession of the prophets, nor help of the righteous. There is the proclamation of judgment to corruption regarding this way, to the fire and the path that leads to the glowing coals. Therefore, this is one Torah by one world and an end for all those who exist. Then he will make alive those whom he has found, and he will purge them from their sins. At the same time, he will destroy those who are polluted with their sins. Come on, man. He's not playing. So he commands that Israel walk before him. Be ye perfect, for I, your Abba in heaven, am perfect. If Yah said be perfect, you can do that. That's all that there is to it. Let us take a great delight in the word of Yah. Let us rejoice in the highness of these great days that Yah has bestowed upon us, as we are in preparation for the emergence of Yah's Kodesh days in the coming weeks and months ahead. I'm going to take great delight, because these are the cultures that Yah has commanded that Israel keep. Nations today, they're happy with their Christmas, their Easter, and all those things, and we get caught up in the same festivities as them. But then when the days of Yah come around, we don't even have a clue. You got to reverse that, my friend, because he wants his people to rejoice and to be delighted in his word. Yah is coming, and he's going to establish this kingdom on this earth, whether the nations like it or not. HaMashiach must rule until he has put all enemies, that's what the book says, until he has put all enemies under his feet. And even then, he'll give up the kingdom to the Father, Abba Yahweh, that Yahweh may be all in all. Man, that's serious. He's going to take this earth right back to its original Edenic state. Come on, man. Don't you yearn for that? The more you study the word, the more it makes perfect sense. See, the Gentiles, they don't believe it. That's all right. You stay over there where you're at and stop believing. But the way Yah commands that this thing be done, and then he gives the messengers, the nabis, the ability to utter words of great profoundness so that it unlocks our understanding. It removes the stupor from our mind to look up and say, Abba Yahweh is great. Yisrael, we total Yah for the greatness, the kindness of today. We're going to be dismissed here. We're going to have our closing prayer during the midst of our afternoon recess. We're going to have a prayer and a special blessing by young sister Naomi Amina Johnson, who will be formally introduced to you, the congregation of Israel, because she's passed the 80-day period of time and she's allowed to enter into the house of Yah. So I want to make certain that we rejoice in that. Every time there's a new vessel in the assembly of Yah that's born in this earth, we'll do that. We'll introduce one another. We'll have a formal day where we do just that. so that we count those worthy to enter in that Yah counts worthy. And we hold on to Yah's unchanging hand that we might be the people that he's calling for, the people that will do his will. He said concerning Father Abraham, he says, I know him, that he will instruct his children and his children behind him to keep my law. Did he do it? Yes, he did. Yah says in his word, Abraham's going to wake up and he's going to look around and say, these, my children, where have they been? Going to get up, man, like he's been napping. Going to look around and see his seed has just spread out all over the earth. Come on. The man didn't see the depth and the greatness of what Yah promised unto him. Dawid, he didn't live to see the house extended forever like Yah said that he would. But he is not a man that he should lie. Come on, Yisrael. That word is beautiful, especially when you sit down and you get into it, sure enough, and realize, wait a minute, he's talking to me. He's talking to you. He's talking to his people and to all that will obey him. Come on, man. They ain't got enough scholars in the world to refute that. These men are just wasting their time. So I say to you, hold on to Yah's unchanging hand. We total Yah for your greatness, for your kindness, for your offerings of support. All the things that you've done, food, meal offering, drink offering, just the kindness of opening the Torah with us today on the Shabbat. We total Yah for that. If you're ever by any chance in the Baltimore, Washington area, feel free to stop by and keep Shabbat with us at 6515 Harford Road. That's Baltimore, Maryland. The zip here is 21214. As well as if you'd like to briefly talk with me, we have phone calls that we can take questions from time to time. Y'all willing, give directions on how to arrive. I can even be reached at area code 443-326-2565, and we'll do the best that we can to accommodate you, to open the Torah of Yah unto you, to send out the literature and the tracts and CDs and the various things that we're able to do to enlighten one another in Yah's word. And may the blessings of Yah continuously rest upon you all. Children of Yisrael here in Baltimore, let us do this. Let's stand to our feet as we close today's Shabbat observation with prayer as we turn to the east. Abba Yahweh, we come before you as we total you for the greatness of your Hasid upon each and every soul that's represented here. From the oldest of us down to the youngest, we beg of you in the name of Yahshua HaMashiach that you watch over us, blessing us, keeping us, comforting us at all times. Continue to open our hearts and minds to the great and wondrous things that are written in your Torah that we may be able to walk up perfectly in them. We ask that you not allow us to stray out of the pathway of thy truth to neither the right hand nor to the left, but to forever walk up before you in a manner that's clean, honorable, and perfectly acceptable in your sight. We ask that wherever your people may be found, as we are scattered throughout the face of this entire earth, that you be with all real and true Yisrael Yah, as well as many among the nations that are to awaken and come unto you. We ask that the blessings and the fullness of Almighty Yah be with us. May Yahweh bless you and keep you. May Yah make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto thee. May Yahweh lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Shabbat shalom, Yisrael Yah. Shalom, shalom. Hallelujah. Happy Sabbath unto you all. Hallelujah.